I think he said Whiteman Park is a hoot. Come to EnviroFest 2024. Learn about Whiteman Park's birds and discover ways to improve your sustainability with hands-on workshops and demonstrations. Plus, there'll be market stalls, food trucks, and heaps of kids' activities. EnviroFest 2024 at Whiteman Park on March 23 from 10 till 3. You'd be wise to go to whitemanpark.com.au.
The Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie podcast.
How good is that? It is Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie for your Thursday podcast. Today, just you simple, yeah. You only had one job, mate. Those calls. You get one job at work and you completely stuff it up. And I hate doing this. I really hate doing it because I know that they're one of the most honest professions out there, but a real estate agent is stuffed up.
It's not fair, mate.
You're a big fan of the estate agent.
I have never met a dishonest real estate agent.
You've never met a real estate agent. They don't lie. They're good people and they find people wonderful homes.
Yeah, they do. They create memories.
Yeah.
Oh, they do. Yeah. But this one real estate agent, she had one job, and I think it was to sell the house, and she didn't do that. You'll find out what it is in the podcast.
This is the Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie podcast.
Let's talk about the tequila called Fletcher, because one man, Marky Mark Wahlberg, is promoting it. I mean, he's in Sydney for a couple of months, which is great, and everyone's seen him out and about. He's playing a bit of a game with a few bottle shops around Sydney. Yeah. He's wandering in to see if they stock his tequila. It's a bit of a game for the person behind the counter. Our video is up on the Fitz and Whipper Kate Ritchie social platforms. Go and have a look on the gram.
Do you remember when our boss's personal assistant was, her name was Wanda?
Oh yeah.
What?
So We gave each other a challenge, Kate, that you had to ring Wanda and you had to get as many words with the word Wanda in it into the conversation.
How ridiculous and childish.
It's a great game. I mean, things
and
like...
And you criticising theme coin.
Well, she was a big Stevie Wonder fan.
Oh, that's not even the word, though. What else could you do?
She had no idea what we were doing.
Yes, she did.
No, she didn't, Kate. She didn't.
And we'd go, hey, just wondering...
Oh, you know what? You know what I'm sitting here thinking? Oh, gee, I wish I was on the show then. I would have loved to have been part of that unpredictable fun.
What do you want to do about it? That was another one. That was a good one. What do you want to do about it?
Can we have a listen to Mark Wahlberg? This is Vintage Sellers Yesterday. And I want to point out also just his attempt on the Aussie accent. Have a listen.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. We are in Australia in the search for Fletcher. And we're going to go to Vintage Cellars right now to find
him. What's up, bro? You got Fletcher's little tequila?
Hello, mate. Yeah, we're just over there, man.
Oh, s***. When did it come in?
Yesterday.
Oh, the good s***. Right. Look at that. Wow.
Can I help you? Yeah, you want tequila? Dolly? You've been into a bit of mischief.
It's arrived. Wow. Down under. Hell yes.
Has he been watching Chopper?
A little bit of mischief. I dislike nothing more than people who try the Australian accent.
Can I help you? Yeah, you want tequila? Dolly, you've been into a bit of mischief.
It's arrived.
The Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie podcast.
A multi-million-dollar home was accidentally burnt to the ground by a real estate agent in one of Sydney's most prestigious suburbs.
What?
You only had one job, but Julie Bundock is her name, Sydney real estate agent. Julie was, you know, Jules. Guys, I can get you $3.3 million for your house on Riverview Road in Avalon Beach.
Very nice spot.
Oh, the view's stunning. The landscape's breathtaking. The people questionable around that area, but it's still an amazing place. You know, and typical real estate agent, I'll get you $3.3 million 2 weeks later. Market's dropped.
Yeah. Maybe just over two. I
got you 3.3 from the insurance company.
Three months later, you wouldn't believe it.
Probably
the wrong time to sell. You're probably looking at about 1.8 now.
Yeah, I'd aim for September. Let's take it off for a little bit.
Well, Julie, we won't even get 1.8 now because you've burnt down the house. So there was an open inspection coming out and Julie removed the sheets from one of the beds.
Yeah.
She threw them downstairs. So she was up on the first level balcony,
yeah,
and she threw them downstairs onto a shelf, onto a light, Kate,
yeah,
which she then switched on afterwards, mm, had no idea that the sheets were on the light. She's turned the light on. About 20 minutes later, a major fire broke out. The four-bedroom home on Riverview Road was engulfed in flames.
Oh, no, imagine.
You know what? That could happen to anybody. Like, if you're in a rush and you've got an open home and you're trying to clean the place up, you throw some sheets down. Let's get them out of the way. Oh, that light's on. That should be fine. Oh, my God. What's that smell? Smoke.
Yeah.
Julie and the real estate company then said, well, it's we can't really pay for this. Classic real estate line. We can't really do this. It didn't help in court, though, when Miss Bundock said the words to the effect of, oh, my God, Pete, I think I've burnt your house down.
Okay, so that's kind of some evidence that's gone against her, sort of admitting guilt normally.
How awful. But, I mean, Julie is selling the house, but she's also stripping the bed. That's what I'm confused.
She shouldn't be doing that. Should she?
Why is she doing that? Is she cleaning it as well?
Well, she's trying to do her best. I know that much, Kate. I went out with a girl who was a real estate agent. She was doing an open for home and then realised that the plants on the balcony of this apartment didn't look great. So she put the hose on, showed the people through, left, forgot about the hose. Flooded the entire apartment, which went through the ceiling into the next apartment.
Yeah, great. Mm. What a good day it was. Mm-hmm.
Well, she moved to Byron.
They ended up having to, the real estate company and Julie herself ended up having to pay $862,000 in damages. The judge said that noted that Miss Bundock was aggressive and uncooperative witness in court. Her evidence was clearly coloured by a heightened awareness that she had caused the catastrophe.
Mm. Well, who are you going to blame?
Yeah, how do you argue
the
it?
The dog.
The dog didn't throw the sheets, did it?
Do you know what? Do you know when I told you about Colony Furniture? My first job, Kate, my job was that I had to remove. So they would rip down a house. All the timber from the house, Kate, would arrive at the furniture company.
Yeah.
And they would make furniture out of that old timber. But my job was to take all the nails out of the wood all day.
Very important job.
8 hours a day.
Yeah.
Now, I said to myself, really, do you need to take the nails out? Because you've got these high-powered sanders and stuff like that. It's not going to be that bad. Until I realised that I left a couple of nails in, Whip, and then when you put that wood, they glue that wood together to make one big sheet. When you put it through the sander, it can actually catch on the nail and then it flicks out the back.
Oh, Jesus.
One nail went into one of the other employees' shin.
Got him.
Oh!
And what did you do?
You only had one job, mate. You just had to take the nails out of the wood.
Yeah. We're paying you to take the nails out.
Why is one of them in Steve's leg?
Oh, it's not very fleshy on the old shin either.
No, it's
is
not.
It?
Got him. If you stick enough Steves together, you'll make the perfect bit of timber.
Zara, in Greenacre, you only had one job. Stuffed it up. What was it, Zara?
I work in a cafe and my one job is pastry. And one night when I went to clean the fridge, I accidentally turned it off and I lost over $2,000 worth of pastry. And I had to throw them all out.
Zara, was that on your head? Do you have to pay for that?
Thank God I don't have to pay for that, but they have cut my shifts back, so that's maybe a sign.
Not to mention the time it would have taken.
Mate.
Yeah.
But you know what? Your new fashion line's doing really well. Well done. No, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
I think it's a different Zara. Jamie and
let's go to H&M now. H&M, are you there?
It's just Jamie and Wollongong. I don't believe Jamie has a fashion outlet, unless you do, Jamie.
No, I don't.
No, but you've got you had one job. What's your story?
So I used to work at a function centre and I was serving the meals and my boss had said to me, don't give table 9 and 13 bacon pasta because they're Muslim. And I walked up to 13 and laid all the bacon pasta down. He realised just in time before one of the men nearly was having a bite.
Jamie.
Don't you search for bacon. If you don't eat bacon, don't you search for bacon. What? Shouldn't you just check?
They probably would have never tasted how, you know,
the bacon because it wasn't really bacon.
I mean, but see, the other thing.
Are you saying the food was flavourless, Jamie?
No, I mean they would have been like, what is this delicious
Yes. This is the thing.
I mean, because really, how good's bacon?
Well, this is the thing. Once that one of the reasons they don't do it is because they know how good it will be when they first taste it.
Is that right?
Jamie, thank you.
Leslie in Box Hill, you only had one job, Leslie.
It was to compile a report together for basically all the profit and loss that we'd had for a furniture supplier.
Mm-hmm.
And I compiled all the information and all the trade pricing, basically all the intel for a very large furniture company that's across Australia, and I sent it to the competitor.
Oh, Leslie. Did you realise the minute you hit send?
No, I realised it when my manager rang me from overseas and she was flipping her lid. But I was 3 months pregnant and I hadn't told her yet, so it was baby brain next level.
Oh, my God. Thank God for the baby getting you out of there.
Leslie, you know what I would have done? I would have rung the competitor immediately and I would have gone, you've got to get me on board. I'm helping you out here. Give me a job and give me more pay. That would have been smart.
Yeah, but how good would it have been too when you admitted to the stuff up and then said, by the way, I'm also pregnant. I'm going to need maternity leave for 3 years.
Use baby
exactly.
as an excuse.
Mm-hmm. Perfect.
This is the Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie podcast.
I think he said Whiteman Park is a hoot. Come to EnviroFest 2024. Learn about Whiteman Park's birds and discover ways to improve your sustainability with hands-on workshops and demonstrations. Plus, there'll be market stalls, food trucks, and heaps of kids' activities. EnviroFest 2024 at Whiteman Park on March 23 from 10 till 3. You'd be wise to go to whitemanpark.com.au.
Do you know what? I was a bit emotional over the weekend when Penrith boy, we found out that Tyson Pedro was hanging up his fist in UFC. Got quite emotional talking about it as well. But the exciting thing is he's getting back into the ring. And a very good friend of ours, Danny Green, is behind his boxing career. Danny Green, Tyson Pedro, welcome
guys. Thank you for having us on. Appreciate it.
I mean, congratulations on the UFC, but I'm so excited for the next step. Danny, you must have seen this man fighting in UFC and thought, wow, there's a future somewhere else here. I need him with me.
Yeah, for sure. He's an excitement machine, and people don't realise this. Not many people, unless you know Tyson well. He was an amateur fighter, so he's had his first amateur boxing fight at the age of 15 or 16 years old. And he's 5-0. He's an intermediate state champion. So boxing's always been in his bones. And
awesome.
His father, John, is the pioneer of UFC and cage fighting in this country. He brought King of the Cage out to Australia in 2002. So this bloke's been, you know, he's grown up, you know, fighting and combat sport, but boxing's always been his passion, and I identified that. These guys, we connected. We've known each other for a long time. And it made absolute sense.
Who came in? Volkanovski came in.
Yeah.
And he was talking about, I said, the anticipation and the nerves and that nervous energy before you go into a fight must be something that would blow your mind. And he said, but I do so much work outside of the ring. I know that whoever I'm coming up against isn't going to put me through what they've already put me through.
Mm. Yeah, we have a couple of drills, especially at City Kickboxing, like it's called Spider, and you put yourself in the hardest position. It's 3 rounds, you're building up lactic acid, and then you're also trying to fight off like multiple different fresh opponents. So that's probably the worst thing you'll do in your fight camp, and the point of it is to be harder than any fight, because you might go into a fight and finish it in the first round.
Yep.
Yeah, so you know when you're doing that on a Sunday that it's going to be a worst Sunday you've ever had. So you're almost get more anxiety before that.
Tyce, you're really good mates and you've trained with Israel Adesanya as well. What's the one that he does where he has around about 20 guys just hanging around him, and then after a couple of minutes someone else will jump in and go hard on him again?
God. Yeah, that's the spider drill we do every Sunday. It sucks. Balls.
Oh. Every Sunday?
Yeah.
So that ruins your Saturday night.
Yeah.
You're actually taking this seriously. Danny, when you look at opponents for Tyson, I mean, you know who's out there. You understand the landscape. Are there some names you're running through in your mind about some possible fights?
We've got a few people lined up. I'm actually pretty nervous who these guys want to fight, and they're pushing me to fight these guys. This Tyson Pedro's is not here to compete. He's here to make a statement. He's here to become a champion.
Yeah,
you know, it's a bold statement. It's a bold move. And the guy that they've earmarked to fight, and we're still negotiating. When people realise who he's fighting, if we get this across the line, they're going to be like, "What?
Really?
First fight? You're kidding?"
Tyson, can I just ask you quickly? You're at Penrith boys, is that right? And you will. will be living back in Penrith? Yeah. I mean, you'll be working hard, I guess, and training and not getting a minute to yourself, but you're home now with your family. What is it about Penrith that you're kind of looking forward to just being at home and doing again?
Well, I've been living in Penrith since I was born in a Penrith hospital, so
I'm
Penrith through and through. But, yeah, it'll be good just to get back to home, see all my friends and family. And, like, obviously we have Drink West out there with Nathan Cleary and Ty Tuivasa. Yeah. So just getting to look after things when I'm away, it's sort of phone off and concentrate on everything else. So yeah. It's good to be coming home and get that sorted.
You're bigger out west than Bam Bam, aren't you? Have to be when you're
talking. No, definitely not. He's bigger everywhere. Especially in clothes sizes.
Is Bam Bam going to keep going? You still reckon he's got a couple of years in him, Tice? Yeah. Or do you reckon he'll be hanging up soon?
I think he's got quite a few on his contract left. So,
yeah, hey, I mean, Danny, as a profile piece, wouldn't be bad to me, because I know he's been training in UFC, but to put on the boxing gloves could be Mark Zuckerberg.
Oh,
you know, there was a bit of training going on at one stage.
Well, I've been blocked for a month on Facebook, so give him to me.
What have you done, Danny?
I didn't even say anything controversial.
I love your social
posts. Yeah, but what's your idea of not controversial in the average person's kind of rules and regulations around not controversial?
You mean Danny's honest?
Could be two different
things.
Yeah,
well, I don't sugarcoat it. And I want to tell it how it is, because the fabric of our society is slowly deteriorating. We need people to go, not on with that junk.
Yeah.
No.
Actually, can I get your thoughts, Danny and Tyson, on this one? Because everyone's talking about Jake Paul, Mike Tyson. And everyone's Jake Paul's going to get absolutely flogged here. But people don't understand, Mike Tyson's 58 years of age. So, Danny, what kind of Mike Tyson are we going to see in this fight?
He's probably going to come out to a Cypress Hill song, in a cloud of smoke, and he'd be chilling on the way out, and he'd be chilling on the way in, and he'd be chilling on the way out.
So you don't reckon it's serious in any way?
Oh, look, who knows? But you know, Jake Paul's is a professional fighter, and he's got youth on his side, and yeah, he's 58 years old. You know, I'm 51, and when you get you'll get there, boys. When you get older, and you start from 51 last week, it slides a lot quicker than it does when you're 40 to 50, from 30 to 40. Yeah, so from 50 to 60, the downhill slopes is a lot quicker.
Yeah, but I reckon there would be younger boxers out there that when you hit 58 wouldn't want to get in the ring with Danny Green.
Don't come near me, man. I'm still fresh. I've got the iron. But I'm not going near this bloke here.
No
chance. I'll pick my mark.
You're a good man, Tyson Pedro. We really appreciate your time. Good luck with the boxing career, mate. We're going to follow it for sure. We'd love to get you back in the studio at some stage.
100%. Thank you for having me on. Appreciate it.
Good luck, brother.
No worries.
And McGreen Whizzle, thank you for coming.
McWhizzle, McFitzwhizzle, we really appreciate your support. As always, you guys have been legends. And, look forward to doing more work with you. Great to see you. And Kate as well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie podcast.
I want to talk about grandparents, okay? And in particular, what happened on the grandparents' watch? Because, I mean, thankfully, if you have you have parents who can help out with the kids, it's great.
Very handy.
You know, childcare is very expensive, and there's a lot to do, especially if you've got more than one.
Well, Heather's very good, isn't she?
She's amazing. My mum is amazing, not only to me, but to all of the kids in our family. But grandparents don't always parent or do things with your children that they're meant to do. They take matters into their own hands because they know how to parent better.
Mm-hmm.
13, 24, 10. What happened when Nan and Pa were in charge? This is hilarious because it got me clicking, because the headline was around woman applauded for demanding parents get noses pierced before they can see the granddaughter again. So I'm like, oh, wow, okay, well, what's awesome. Happened? Yeah. What have they done? And it turns out Nan and Pa have taken their granddaughter, without talking to the parents of the child, taken the very young toddler to get her ears pierced without checking with mum and dad first.
Wow.
Okay.
Which is a really big deal. I mean, the grandparents...
There's a chat to be had there, isn't there?
Well, absolutely. Their excuse was, well, we had your ears pierced when you were a young girl, and so we kind of feel as though that's something that we would like to do.
Yeah, but that was your decision. This one's not.
Absolutely.
Well, see, to have a Broadway shopping centre for us, and mum and dad were over, and Lenny, mum said, oh, I want to buy you something from Broadway. What would you like? And Lenny said, I want my ear pierced.
Did they get his ear pierced?
Yeah. But Mum turned around to us and said, can we do it? I said, well, if he wants it, go for it. It's all yours, Nan. And he went and got his ear pierced.
Is it still pierced?
Yeah, still pierced. Still pierced.
What does
still
he have it? In it? Like a little Nike tick?
Actually, do you know what's cute? Is one of his best mates at school, Jesse, I had his parents coming up to me going, well, Lenny's influenced Jesse already because Jesse now wants his ear pierced. So they've both got their ear pierced now. No.
But at least you were there to peer over his shoulder and say, okay, mate, if you want to do that, I know it's Nanny's influence, but you can go ahead and do it. But grandparents are allowed to do cheeky things like give them ice cream for dinner.
Yeah, spoil them a bit.
But even things like introducing things into the house that Nan and Pa shouldn't be doing, like maybe consoles or devices or things like that.
They break the rules.
Yeah.
We were away for a weekend as a family, and I'd gone to the bathroom or something, and I came back, and Ted... Well, I don't know if I can say this.
Why?
Ted had a sip.
Oh, I know. Of cordial.
Of cordial. Cordial spritz.
Yeah.
And I said, he's on the. Teaching him young. Well done, mate.
What's going on here?
He'll be in Europe in no time.
And Mum said,
oh, don't worry, it won't hurt.
Don't worry, it's just a little bit. I said, that's not the point.
No, that's how
you
it
don't
starts.
Give kids get cordial spritz.
Yeah, without a Ralph Lauren top on. Get one on him straight away before he even thinks about having that.
He popped a collar, we got a dozen natural, and it was the perfect meal. Lovely vinaigrette. Jerry,
he's
welcome to the show.
Gone into boat chair and now he's having a great time.
Hello, Jerry.
Hey, come on.
Good, buddy. The grandparents got it wrong, did they, mate?
They did, yeah. We my six-month-old daughter at the time, who had never eaten solid food, we brought her down to... We were in Ireland and we brought her to a bar with my dad and my parents. And I went to the toilet. My ex-wife went to the car, came back, and my dad is scooping ice cream into the baby's mouth.
Oh, and fed the chocolate to the dog.
No, and she wouldn't have been happy about it.
I thought you were about to say Irish stew or something, and there was a huge potato going into their mouth.
He drunk a Guinness.
He probably would have, maybe a bit of Guinness as well. You wouldn't know, you know?
Jerry, thanks for your call, buddy.
Michaela and San Susie, what did your grandparents stuff up, Michaela?
Hi, guys. Back when I was little, my grandma used to take care of me. And when I was four, she left a cigarette. She was a heavy smoker. She left a cigarette on the table in an ashtray. And I thought I'd be really cheeky and have a puff of it because it must taste good because she was always puffing away at it. And then, obviously, when it didn't, I pretended like nothing happened and put it back while coughing up a storm.
How old were you, Michaela?
Four.
Oh, are you a smoker now, Michaela? Or
no,
did it put you off for life?
I like to tell people that was my first and only time I've ever smoked.
Oh, dropped home to Mum and Dad, smelling like an old pub.
Smelling like an ashtray.
Oh, my God.
I saw something on Instagram the other day where it was like, if you're a kid of the 80s, how hilarious, because one of the big activities that we would have all done was made ashtrays for Mum and Dad. Yeah.
And they were the worst ashtrays ever.
They were either with paddle pop sticks or pottery.
Oh. And you'd have your little curved out resting place for your durry.
Oh, for your jasper. Jeez. Sarah's in Thornley. What happened for you, Sarah?
My grandma was looking after me when I was quite young, probably 5 or 6 years old, and I fell off my grandma's balcony and sliced my leg open. My grandma passed out, but when she came to it, she just thought, oh, a Band-Aid would do, and my mum got there and saw it. She had to take me up to the hospital. I ended up getting several stitches in my leg.
Oh, no.
Because, I mean, if it's an injury and the grandparents are in charge, they're going to try and play it down, of course. A Band-Aid will fix it.
Yeah.
She's fine. I love our Nan's passed out because she couldn't handle the blood as well.
No, she'd been drinking. Oh, my God. Sarah, thanks for your call. Where was your mum, Kate, when you got your nipple pierced? Like, shouldn't someone have...
Well, she was at home wishing I'd never joined radio.
Was that a radio stunt?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought it was just out of choice.
No, it wasn't. And I've still got the little bar in a jar at home. We should give it away.
Kate's nipple piercing?
Yeah. Giving your car away? Now we could give that away.
Yeah.
Everybody wins.
This is the Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie podcast.
I think he said Whiteman Park is a hoot. Come to EnviroFest 2024. Learn about Whiteman Park's birds and discover ways to improve your sustainability with hands-on workshops and demonstrations. Plus, there'll be market stalls, food trucks, and heaps of kids' activities. EnviroFest 2024 at Whiteman Park on March 23 from 10 till 3. You'd be wise to go to whitemanpark.com.au.
Hey, Richie.
Queen. Oh, I know how much we love this game, guys.
It's a bit easy, this game, but I'll play along.
You just said before, this is the easiest game we play.
And what did you say to me after that?
I left a pause. I thought about it long and hard.
And then you said, there was two words.
I said, you're entitled to your opinion.
That's
Whipper,
more than two words.
Please leave me alone during the song so I can prep for the next round of Theme Queen. Welcome to round 8. I am your host.
Sell yourself in, mate. What do you
Come
got?
Come on, mate.
Okay.
Talk it up.
I am your host, the president of Super Club, and a joy to work with on and off the air, Kate Ritchie. Wow. Give her a round of applause.
What if everyone had just heard what you said to know?
Okay, we know the game is simple. Apparently, it's very easy. There are three rounds. In each round, there are three songs. We're going to do it a little bit differently today.
I'd play the three songs together.
Guess what? We're going to do it exactly the way you would like it because Great. The songs have been packaged up. So don't jump in and drag it out like I am now. The songs are all related by a theme. You just got to pick the theme. Here we go. Round 1. We can't stop, and we won't stop. See that? Seamless.
Oh, I love that song. Intro station.
I'm not enough, but I still stay. They've got it in the booth. The guys in there have got it.
Is that the cause?
Can't stop, shake it and stay? Is it something to do with move?
July is the name of that song. I think you...
I don't even know what the last song is.
You're getting caught up with the names of the songs.
Okay.
And maybe not the people who sing them.
It's their family members of Miley Cyrus.
Yes!
Yes! What was the first one?
We Can't Miley. Stop, Miley Cyrus. Miley. Metro Station, the brother is in that. Great song, you're right, Fitzy. Not so easy after all. Heading into round number 2.
Wow. I don't care. I love it. I don't care. Iconic pop.
Oh, is that Australian band? Is
there I've got it.
Who are they?
Madness?
What do we got?
They're all from car commercials.
Ooh, drop one of the words in your
They're all from commercials.
Yes!
Thank you.
You guys, one to Fitzy, one to Whip.
Oh, my God.
We're having a tiebreaker.
We're having a great time. That's what we're bloody having
oh
in here.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, we are. You doubted me. Round number 3. Look at this photograph.
Oh, yes. Every time I do,
it makes me laugh. Classic.
Is that Bieber?
Baby, I'm perfect for you.
No,
it's an old One Direction. Because this is a bit tricky, this one.
Okay, so can you break it down? We had Nickelback to start with.
And what was that song called? Let's have a listen to that one. Photograph.
Photograph.
Okay.
What was the Every song? Time I do it makes me laugh.
Song number 2 was this one.
Bad Habits.
Bad Habits. So Photograph, Bad Habits, and then the third song by One Direction. Perfect.
Well, who sang the second song?
I feel a lot of criticism about to roll in.
Who sang the second song?
It doesn't really matter who sang the
fifth time.
It doesn't matter who sang the second song. A guy called Billy Field. It's a very old one. It's more about what the names of the
Photograph
songs
Bad Habits.
Are.
Is it something to do with the Royals, Kate? No? Is there
Absolutely not. Although it could have something to do with
they're all about photography.
Pop royalty, music industry royalty.
Oh, paparazzi, photograph, bad habits. Who's got a bad habit in sending photos of their...
Tommy, you look like you want to say something.
Well, yeah, I feel like there's a similarity when you go photograph and then you go bad habits and then you go perfect, all Ed Sheeran song.
Yes!
Really good one. That's the best theme queen.
Thank you so much for that ascendancy.
Really good effort.
This is the Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie podcast.
What have you got, Kate Ritchie? Why are you laughing?
I'm not laughing because I know we're going to get out of here soon, but I just thought we should revisit the failed world record attempt.
Best effort is a win.
Magnificent to watch.
It was magnificent. Let's just revisit that just now. Let's cast our minds back to Friday.
57-57 over the 300 metres. He's away in the bodysuit.
Great pace, mate!
Go, mate!
And his little body is just chugging along.
Go, Whipper!
Is he only 44? Jeez, he's had hard life. He's on the top turn now at the halfway mark. He's about to be joined by a bloke with a mullet.
Alfred Webb, quicker!
What am I on?
He's got about another 10 metres to go. Oh, he's slowing right down to a walk. He may have torn a hamstring.
Go, Whipper!
Now, there it is. He won't beat the record of 57.57. The official time is...
1 minute flat, 0.62.
And remarkably, he's clapping himself. Why? I'll never know.
Oh, look, I think it was cute that you were giving yourself a clap. It was a failed attempt, but you really...
I gave it my best.
You did turn up on the day. You had a cheer squad there. But the one thing we've failed to do this week when we've been revisiting the highlights and the lowlights is to speak to Helena herself, who is the young girl who still holds the world record for six-year-olds, 57.57. Good morning, Helena.
Hi, Helena.
Hello.
Now, Helena, can we ask, now I know that you have been training so much, you got some shin splints and stuff like that, and you had to recover, but did everyone know about Whipper going for this attempt? Did you know about it?
Yes.
Were you hoping that he might beat your world record, or what? Did you think he could?
I kind of.
Yeah.
Well, you believed in me, did you, Helena? Because do you know what? I thought of you. When that gun went off and I started running, I was thinking of you and I was thinking where you would be in this race. And I tell you what, you'd understand this. Well, Helena and I would understand this together. That last 100 metres, Helena, now that's where you really need to push yourself, isn't it?
Yes, it really is.
I was so tired, Helena.
Is that the hardest part of the race, Helena? The last 100? Or what's the hardest for you?
Well, it's kind of the start and then the last 15 metres.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Yeah, but Helena, you know what? You have to take so many more steps because Whipper would weigh probably four times as much as you and he's a lot bigger as well. So with one step that he takes, you would have to take three steps.
That's right.
That's right. I agree. The difference between you and I now, Helena, because we both gave it our best and you can't ask any more, is that you've got a world record and I'm just a guy who knows a six-year-old with a world record. So congratulations to you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, congratulations. While we have you on the line and Whipper's listening, surely you have some advice for Whipper, like if he was to attempt this again, like what is it that you think when you're out there, what kind of advice do you have for Whipper to make him a better and faster runner?
Well, I do have two tips from two of my very good coaches, and they're both a really good coaches. One of them is cheek-to-cheek, where you have to put one hand on your cheek and then the other hand on your other cheek, and then fast arms while you're doing that.
Oh, fast arms while you're doing that. That's how high you have to have your arms, isn't it? You've got to pump them right back.
Okay.
And then that gets your legs going, Helena.
Yeah, and what's the other piece of advice?
Always try your best.
Always try your best. True. Helena, have you ever watched your daddy play for the Sydney Swans?
Yes.
Yes. So you've been disappointed by a grown man twice then, have you, Helena?
Oh,
this dad.
Got him.
Got him with beauty. Steph cooked him.
Oh, Helena, we think you are great and we wish you all the very best in your running career ahead of here.
Thank you.
Helena, you are a superstar and we wanna continue following your career. So we're going to watch you. But you need to have a rest now. Focus on school and all your friends and then get ready for Little Athletics next year, okay?
Thank you.
Oh, well done, Helena.
Thanks, Helena.
Sorry, Steph. Sorry, mate. You let the family down.
Thanks, Fitzy.
You don't want to mention
that drive-by, Fitzy. Loved it.
Got him a beauty. Right between the legs.
Thanks so much for listening. If you want more pod, guess what we have? Our full extended chat with Daniel Ricciardo ahead of the Grand Prix on the weekend. Go and find that now. Have a listen.
Fitzy and Whipper with Kate Ritchie is a Nova podcast. For more great shows like this, download the Nova Player via the App Store or Google Play. The Nova Player.
I think he said Whiteman Park is a hoot. Come to EnviroFest 2024. Learn about Whiteman Park's birds and discover ways to improve your sustainability with hands-on workshops and demonstrations. Plus, there'll be market stalls, food trucks, and heaps of kids' activities. EnviroFest 2024 at Whiteman Park on March 23 from 10 till 3. You'd be wise to go to whitemanpark.com.au.